You can say the gospel truth, I go again. But this is the truth, Melvin, is that I have never felt the need to do that. It has come, the mold, if broken on any one point, has come out of the need to do what I was doing. Not how do I break the mold. It's the other way around. So things have happened the way they come. I remember, it always sounds so mundane, but for example, the use of adults to play children in Blue Remembered Hills I was starting to write about children, and I wanted to write something difficult because children don't have long speeches. You can't have flashbacks to non-existent memories. You can't have certain rhetorical devices. You have to have a continual twitchy action because that's how children move. These are a group of seven-year-olds. And the only way I could see, while keeping exactly to the language of childhood and the movements of childhood and the constant present tense preoccupations of childhood, to show it without that filter coming in the way, which an audience going, children, and immediately pushing it back to childhood, was by using seven adult actors. Once you get over the panic of the first 5 minutes when I was watching, thinking, oh my God, is this going? Colin Welland with his great fat ass and his great shorts waddling, sploshing through mud, making airplane noises, and chewing on an apple. I thought, it's going to be one of those dire dread embarrassments, because it ain't going to work. And yet, people could see that it was, after a while, people could see, obviously, that these were adults. Obviously, that goes without saying. But they also saw that they were children. And then, so it worked. But it wasn't because I was trying... You see what I'm getting at? I was trying to show childhood not at one remove, but straight on.
What about bringing in popular songs, as you did say, Pennies from Heaven?
I wanted to write about... in a sense, it sounds condescending. I don't mean it quite this way. I wanted to write about the way popular culture is an inheritor of something else. You know, that cheap songs, so-called, actually do have something of the Psalms of David about them. They do say the world is other than it is. They do illuminate odd... This is why people say, listen, they're playing our song or whatever. It's not because that particular song actually expressed the depth of the feelings that they felt when they met each other and heard it. It is that somehow... It re-evokes and pours out of them yet again, but with a different coating of irony and self-knowledge, those feelings come bubbling back. So I wanted to write about popular songs in a direct way. So it became just a technical problem for me. I thought, I'm not interested in writing a musical. A musical has a different grammar whatsoever, The action builds to a song, and the song caps it, and then it moves on. And the song is, has a different function in a musical. Is how do I get that music from way down there in the back, or here in the ear, or at the side? How do I get it straight bang up in front? And then I thought, well, they lip sync things now and again, sometimes there's a bad performance or they dub from one language to another that way. Why don't I just try making the actor move his lips to the words of the song and see if it, then I tried it a bit. I tried it with myself in a mirror, and that was fun. And I was a great singer. In fact, it was like pre-karaoke, And again, rather than looking, I wasn't breaking a mold as such. I just found the ideal way of making these songs so real.
Just like, and I can understand it, the use of this word, controversial, but there were many times, but let's take a couple of the times when you really seem to bump into opinion in this country. You're on this most popular, extraordinary medium of television, which was doing things in the 60s and 70s in this country, and in many areas which people had never dreamt it could do, in terms of original writing, in your case, in terms of... Well, it was reaching out in all directions, let's leave it at that. And taking on the public in a big way. there were can we talk about two times you really sort of bumped into them? One was to do with when you brought the notion of the devil, we're talking brimstone and treacle, the notion of the devil. And another was to do with sex in Black Eyes. Mm. Now, somehow it seems to me these two things are directly related, but let's talk about them one at a time. What do you think was happening in the brimstone and treacle row and then in the business of sex on television?
Brimstone and treacle was... can I break off for a second? I need a swig of that. There's liquid morphine in that thing. And I'll keep going, but I can you unscrew that cash?
Sure, sorry.
This is not agitation about brimstone and treacle, by the way.
Do you want another drink?
I wouldn't mind, yeah.
Yeah.
Why do you think you got so much resistance in brimstone and treacle?
That's a very complicated story. But if I could put it in the essence as I saw what I was trying to do, you know, it's a simple flip over of an ordinary sentimental religiose rather than religious parable. In that there is an afflicted house, variously afflicted, but in particular with a crippled, seemingly mindless, struck girl, young girl. And there is a visitor, and the visitor brings her to life and makes her speak. Now, if that visitor were an angel, then that's all you would have, is sanctimoniousness. You would learn nothing about anything. And I chose in my head, and this is how it began, this is why I'm talking this way, it began in my head as like that. What if it were the devil? Instead of making that easy distinction, which on the whole only the blasphemous make, non-religious people make this distinction very easily between so-called good, so-called evil, when, of course, they are interrelated. One is defined in terms of the other. One cannot exist without the other, which is why a Satan was an angel, you know. And all art of any kind has attempted to deal with this, has had to deal with it, the dualism of it. So instead of the angel coming and rescuing the cripple and the dumb and the afflicted, I had the devil do it. And an evil act can lead to good consequences. A good act can lead to evil consequences. This is often the case, and it is incomprehensible. It is as though, you know, the rain falls on the just and upon the unjust. It is so. Now, it appeared disgusting because it was a devil and because it was a rape or the beginnings of a rape that made her cry out. And interestingly, the cry out was actually an accusation against her father. That complexity is, as I say, simply a reversal of what would have been sanctimonious and sentimental. Now, that is what offended and afflicted people. I remember Alistair Milne, who was then director of programmes of television at the time, saying that letter to me, something like brilliantly made and written, so and so, but nauseating. Nauseating. Diabolical. Exactly the right word. It was diabolical. It was meant to be. Nauseating, not in the sense that he meant, nauseating in the sense of making you think about those forces, those circumstances, those afflictions, and the way we manipulate the words good and bad. That, to me, is what it was about.